Good morning. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day. You guys aren't happy about Mother's Day? What? Just a few announcements. You all continue to remember the Hands of Mercy Food Bank. We thank you for that. The Christian Ed Committee meeting that was set up for tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, it has been postponed and will be rescheduled. Also, this evening, Bible study will not meet tonight, and depending on how Paul's cataract surgery plays out, we'll have to let you know when it meets again. The ladies' Bible study on the book of Daniel will meet on, I'm confused, it says Tuesday, May 12th, but Tuesday is the 11th. We got it as the 11th up there on the session meeting. And that's when the session will meet at 6:30, and the ladies' Bible study will meet on Tuesday the 11th at 10 a.m. All right, that was just a typo. Bible study Wednesday evening on the 13th at 7, in person or in Zoom. And if you need assistance with hearing any part of the worship service, please see Richard Payden. Are there any other announcements that we need to make this morning? All right. Catechism question. What are the reasons annexed to the fourth commandment? The reasons annexed to the fourth commandment are God's setting apart 6 days of the week for our own employments, His designation of the seventh day as the Sabbath, That is why we have that. And his own example, the Lord himself worked 6 days and rested on the seventh, and then his own blessing of the Sabbath day. And you can read the scriptures that are there. And now, may the peace of Christ be with you. Let us now pass the peace of Christ. Let's stand now and join in the call to worship, please. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness.
The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty.
The Lord sits enthroned as King forever.
Let us ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Father, you indeed are worthy of our worship. You dwell in splendor, in unapproachable light, and in holiness. So, Father, it is right that we come before you this morning and adore and magnify your name. It is in that name that we pray. Amen.
Let's remain standing for our praise chorus. This morning it's number 58, Bless the Lord, O My Soul. Continue on with number 3, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Oh,
our faith together using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. On this Mother's Day, we want to take just a moment and honor our mothers. I can't think of a better way to do this than to read from the scripture from the 31st chapter of Proverbs, verse 28. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. And we want to give praise and thanks to the Lord for our mothers. And one way we want to do that is we've thought of a lot of different ways to do that, but I can't think of a more unique way and a better way. We have, the church has purchased for all the moms this morning, and I'm not much on flowers. I don't know what kind that is. Everybody here probably does. Anybody tell me? The cards in the... All righty then, since I've made the question there.
Go ahead and pronounce that.
Yeah, a dilapidemia. That sound close? I've never heard of it, but anyway, it's a beautiful flower, and please They're up front here. You'll be able to pick them up going out the back way or out the front door at the end of the service rather than sitting and holding that awkwardly. But we thank God for our moms, for their godliness to us, and for the way that they've raised us in the fear, nurture, and admonition of the Lord. And let's just have a word of prayer. Father, again, we come before you this morning, and we want to raise up to you and thank you and give you praise for our mothers. Father, they have taught us to fear you. They have faithfully passed on a love for the Scripture and a love for your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, may we on this day show them how much we love and care for them. May we honor them and bless them. In your name we pray. Amen. At this time, just want to lift up to you the noisy offering this month, which is going to the Cumberland Presbyterian Children's Home. And if you want to make an offering today, you can leave it in the plate at the back. Most of you probably received yesterday a phone call regarding the Helping Hands ministry. I tried to get that all right on the calling post. If you didn't receive it, there's a need in the church. And if you want to make a contribution to that, you can either give your donation directly to Paul, or you can write a check and put it in the offering plate and mark it Helping Hands to help meet this need within our church family. Now is the time for prayer requests and praise reports, some from this week. Remember the family of Daryl Ramey. Daryl is Betty McCauley's nephew, and he passed away earlier this week. Remember Jerry Roberts. Jerry goes in tomorrow morning for vascular surgery. It's a delicate surgery on his carotid artery. So be in prayer for him and for Robin as well during this time. Are there any other prayer requests or praise reports this morning? Raymond Gettner? Jessica?
Yes, Kelly Walker, and it's Kelly with an I.
Okay.
She's a young mother, 30, with small girls whose cancer they thought was not going to come back, but it has.
Oh, man. Okay. An update on Lori. She's continues to heal and get stronger and is resting. And when she's resting, I have to learn to leave her alone. Amen? Amen. Okay. So we all need, but we both thank you for all of your prayers. Anessa. Anyone else?
I haven't praised my daughter said I could tell her now.
Okay. As long as you have permission.
Anyway, my grandson that plays the bassoon has been accepted to Eastman, which is on the same par as Juilliard. Got a scholarship. And he leaves 1st of August, but he has promised me that, and he's going to play for church.
Well, amen.
We've had a lot of prayers go up, and Richard has absolutely just helped him do that. I give him a lot.
Amen. But let me go ahead and kind of backtrack on some of these prayer requests so that those on Facebook can hear them. I'm bad to not repeat them. But be in prayer for Kelly Walker, who has cancer. That's from Jessica Allred and Molly Wellens, who's dealing with thyroid cancer, and a praise for Sheila's grandson that's going to Eastman Conservatory of Music way up there in the heathen land of New York, I think it is. Doug.
Yes,
Amen. Austin Ryder graduated this past Friday from Tennessee Tech, and that is a word of praise. Now you got to figure out if the boy can get a job or not. June. What was that first name?
Jen Brooks.
Okay. Anyone else? Paul.
Prays for successful surgery in one eye, waiting on the next.
Paul prays for a successful cataract surgery on one eye. And waiting on the next, Jamie.
Just to praise, my dad's doing really well. His surgery for prostate cancer went, I don't know if you say flawlessly, but it went well. Doing all the things that he wants to be doing right now, he will have to do radiation therapy probably for the latter part of the summer. But all things considered.
Okay. So that's a word of praise for Jamie's father, Gene, and he'll be having some radiation therapy toward the end of the summer. But he's out and about and doing what he enjoys to do. Miss Lily. Okay. That's all right. Remember to pray for Blake, who's 6 years old and is dealing with a brain tumor. Anyone else? Eric.
My best friend's older brother, he has a kidney trouble, and he's got COVID and he's in the hospital right now. Doing better. With all of his health condition beforehand, he knows what will happen.
Okay.
But he's going to kill Marbury.
So he's in the hospital, Will Margrave in the hospital with COVID?
COVID, yeah. He has a real bad kidney.
He has other medical issues.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyone else? Well, let us pray. Lord, we come before you this morning and we thank you for who you are once again. We want to bless you and praise you and give you the honor and the glory. Lord, it is to you and you alone that all of our love and praise and adoration is due. Lord, we also come here today and we are burdened by our sin. We have spent the week, Father, some days we feel like we did pretty well in living for you, and other days not so well. Lord, we falter and we fail, and it grieves our hearts because we love you so. So, Father, we come this morning and we confess our failures to you. The times we have spoken out of turn, the times we have been selfish and prideful, the times we have been envious, Father, and all the times that our tongues have been used for gossip or indiscretions, Father, we confess all of these sins to you. And Lord, we know that you are gracious, we know that you are kind, and we know that you have promised to blot out our sins, to take away our transgressions, and to wash us from our iniquity. So, Father, we rejoice. We rejoice in the fact that you restore to us the joy of our salvation and that you are the one who sustains us. Father, we thank you for such goodness to us. We thank you that you hear our prayers as we make our cries to you. And, Father, we lift up these prayer requests to you this morning that have been mentioned by name here. You know each heart. You know each life, Father. Just bring healing to all of those who are facing cancer, those who are preparing for surgery. Father, we just pray for a calm spirit and healing from that procedure. Father, we give you praise and thanks for all of these others that we have mentioned, for graduations and successful surgeries. Father, there are so many things to be thankful for in our lives, for all of the ways that you bless us. And now, Lord, we ask this morning that we would be holy as you are holy. Lord, teach us to be an imitator of your beloved Son, that we might walk in love and forgiveness with one another. Lord, conform us to the image of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. Help us not to love this world. Guard our hearts, Father, that we might not be seduced by the lust of the flesh or of the eyes or of the pride of life. Lord, teach us to be your people in each and every aspect of our lives. And now, gracious God, we close this prayer with the prayer that your blessed and holy Son has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The song that David and I are about ready to sing is called The Prayer. It came from a 1998 Disney movie called Quest for Camelot that was a total flop. And out of that total flop came this beautiful song, and it's been winning awards for many, many decades. It was made famous by Celine Dion and Andrea Bocelli. He's an Italian singer. And even though they never mention God in the song, it's all about God. It's about God looking down on us, giving us his grace, letting us have faith in him to keep us safe. And in these times, I don't know a better song than this song that was created from a movie that didn't make it, from David Foster, who is a man who's not a Christian. So here we go with The Prayer. I pray you'll be our eyes and watch us where we go,
and help us to be wise in times when we don't know.
Let this be our
grace
to a place where we'll be saved.
I pray we'll find your light.
I pray we'll find your light
and hold it in our hearts.
And hold it in our hearts.
When stars go out each night. Light will shine. Let this be our prayer.
Let this be our prayer.
When shadows fill our day.
When shadows fill our day.
Lead us to a place.
Guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved. We're dreaming of a world that has no violence, a world without
ask that life be kind.
We ask that life be kind.
And watch us from above.
And watch us from above.
We won't be so willful.
We won't be so willful.
Another soul to love.
With your grace, give us faith so we'll be saved. And now with this faith, which is in our hearts, we can feel that
got a little warm up here, so take off my jacket. Scripture reading on this Lord's Day comes from 1 John, 5th chapter. Be reading verses 13 through 21, and this message will conclude our series of sermons from John's letter to us. And I trust that it has been a blessing to you. I know that it has been a blessing to me to learn about the assurances, about the way that God loves us and cares for us, and how we can be sure of our salvation in Jesus Christ, because that's been the purpose, or John's purpose, behind the writing. And that purpose, we find it in our very first verse that we read this morning, beginning in verse 13 of the 5th chapter. I write these things to you, who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked of him. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask, and God will give him life. To those who commit sins that do not lead to death, there is a sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is a sin that does not lead to death. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we might know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the one, he is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we come before it now and before you, and we humbly bow down. Lord, may we subject ourselves to your leadership. May we give ourselves over to your truth. In your name we pray. Amen. If you've ever played any football or if you've watched any football, you know the term play action pass. You know what it is. The quarterback takes the snap, fakes it to the running back in hopes to trick the defense, deceive the defense into believing that it's a run, drawing up all the linebackers and the defensive backs in hopes that one of the receivers will go down the field and bam, you know, touchdown or a first down or some sort of big gain. And that's what happens if it's well done. And so it's a play that tries to trick or misdirect the defense. And what John has been telling us throughout his letter here is that Satan is in the habit of running the play action pass. You know, he's trying to deceive believers into thinking that there is no assurance, that there is no certainty of salvation in Jesus Christ. He fakes a handoff and he gets us to doubt God's word. He gets us to doubt the deity of Christ, his atoning death upon the cross, his resurrection, and his soon coming return. He tries to, the enemy of our soul wants us to be looking in one direction instead of looking to Christ and Christ alone. Instead of keeping our eyes upon Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. If we keep our eyes on him, we will not be deceived. And in these closing verses of John's letter, he tells us that we can be certain, that we need not be deceived, and he lifts up for us here, I believe, Christian certainties, things that we can know for certain, as we say here in the South. We can know it with all certainty. And the first certainty comes to us as no surprise. It is the certainty of eternal life. We just read that in verse 13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God. Why? That you may know. That you may know that you have eternal life. This verse not only expresses the purpose of the entire letter of 1 John, I think it's a fitting climax to everything that he said throughout the entire letter. And if we take this verse, the 13th verse of 1 John chapter 5, and its that purpose statement, and we couple it with John's purpose statement in his gospel, which is chapter 20, verse 31, and that reads, "These are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have eternal life in his name." So he writes the gospel so that people may believe. And he writes 1 John so that believers might be assured of that belief. And if you put those two purpose statements together, I think you see a four-step process. First, John's desire is that people may hear, and that in hearing, they might believe. And in believing, they might live. And in living, they might know. And that's how you came to know Jesus, wasn't it? First, you heard about Jesus. Most of you here this morning probably heard the message of the gospel in church. And you heard it multiple times. But there came a day when you heard that message. When you heard God's Spirit working in your heart, in your life, in a way that had happened before. And because of that, you came to believe in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You trusted him as Lord and Savior, and his Spirit came to live inside of you. So there was hearing that gave way to believing. Believing gave way to living. And living brought about knowing. Knowing. To me, it's a little bit like getting married, okay? First, you hear their name. And you might see a picture of them, and then you get a chance to meet them. And in meeting them, you're more interested in them. And then, you know, on it goes. You know, and you become to believe in them. And so much so that you believe the vows that she made on the day of your marriage. So you heard about her, you believed in her, and you know what? Now you live with her. And you live with her, and as you do live with her, you discover that the promises, that the vows that she made all those years ago are the things that you come to know with an absolute certainty. And in the same way, Christian conviction is like that. Genuine faith is not something to be compartmentalized. You can't just say, I have my faith over here. No, faith in Christ and believing in Christ, it covers the totality of your life. And certainty goes hand in hand with humility. Every so often somebody says to me, Dale, that's pretty presumptuous of you, or of anybody, to say that they know they have eternal life. Surely all you can say is that you hope that you have eternal life, or that it may be, that you can say that maybe I have eternal life, but it is utter presumption to say that you know you have it. And that answer goes completely contrary to what you find in the pages of the Bible. The Bible tells us this. It says if God's purpose for us is to hear, and if we hear, we should believe, and if we should live and then know, then you know where the presumption is? It's on our part if we doubt the Word of God. If we doubt God's Word rather than trust His Word. It's not presumption to take God at His Word, is it? We are to believe His Word. And this is what His Word teaches us. That is the certainty of eternal life. Verse 14, John talks about another certainty, the certainty of answered prayer. And this is the confidence that we have toward Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of Him. So let's try to summarize that as what John tells us about prayer. First, because of this certainty of prayer, we know that we can talk to God. Romans 8:15 tells us that God has put His Spirit within our hearts, and we can go to Him and we can say, Abba, Father, quite literally, Daddy or Dada. You're my Father. That's how my relationship, and you know, that's what a child does. Some of the very, very first words of a child are Dada or Daddy, isn't it? Some of those very first words. And you're not going to say, isn't that a strange thing for that child to be saying, Daddy? You're not going to say that. It's a perfectly natural thing for him to be saying that because it's an indication of the relationship between the Father and the Son. And we might also expect the other side of that, that the Father will willingly and attentively hear the infant cries of His child. The same is true with God. We are brought into the reality of eternal life and faith in Jesus Christ. And a key piece of evidence that we have been brought into faith is our prayer life. The non-believer has no genuine sense of an awareness of God when they pray. They have no assurance that they are heard. And one of the things that marks out the reality of our faith is that we can now talk to God. And notice the comprehensive nature of what we can talk about before God. It says there, anything. That's a pretty broad area, isn't it? Anything. Nothing is off limits. We can come to God, our Father, and express our deepest thoughts, our heart's desires, the assurance that He hears us and that He gives us what we ask. At the end of verse 15, it's qualified with the statement, according to His will. Now, we see that qualifier not just here, but Jesus even gives that instruction in the Gospels. And it's there to remind us of the fact that prayer is not a means for us to impose our will upon God. God, we need to do this. I'm going to get you to do this. No, we can't do that. Nor is it a means by which we can bend God's will to our will. But it is the prescribed way for us to humbly come before God and yield our will to His will. That is what it is. And when we come to God in prayer, we may never be more confident when we pray than when we pray Bible prayers. Bible prayers, things that we find in the Scriptures. In the Old Testament, Abraham was promised that through his seed, the whole earth would be blessed, that all the nations of the world would be blessed. So you know what? If you want to pray for the evangelization of the world, if you want to pray for people in India and Pakistan and China to come to know Christ, pray it. It's a promise. And you can be assured that God will hear that prayer because He has made it perfectly clear in His Word that the billions and billions of people in this world that have not heard about Christ can hear about Christ as we pray. So we don't need to wonder about that. We don't need to fiddle around about praying this sort of a prayer because God has given us that promise in His Word. And we have to do this. We have to learn to pray biblically. I don't know what to pray. Open the book of Psalms. Pray the Psalms. Go to the epistles. Paul has prayer after prayer in his letters to the churches. Pray those prayers. Pray and ask God to make you holy as He is holy, pure as He is pure, because that's what the Scripture calls for us to do. God wouldn't ask us to do that if we couldn't pray for Him, pray for His work in our lives. Pray that He would make you useful in His kingdom. And you can pray that prayer. Why? Because it's according to His will. It's according to His will. It's according to His Word. so that we can yield ourselves and submit ourselves to God's good and perfect will. Next, verses 16 and 17, John addresses a particular question, and it has to do with, you know, if you read it, who you can pray for and who you're not supposed to pray for, and it talks about the sin that doesn't lead to death and what is the sin that does not lead to death. And, you know, I made a not so brilliant discovery this week that you can read a lot of stuff on those two verses and not be much better off in knowing what you know when you get done, right? I mean, you might know more, but you might not be more clear on what you think you know. So I hope that what I share does not communicate my lack of clarity on these verses. So verses 14 and 15, notice that they are about a petition. It's petitioning God that you can ask God anything according to his will. And verses 16 and 17 are about intercession, about coming before God and interceding on someone else's behalf. And these verses prescribe to us, if you read them closely, they prescribe to us how to deal with sin in the congregation. Verse 16, if anyone sees his brother or sister committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask and God will give him or her life. In other words, when we discover that a brother or a sister is committing serious sin, our initial response should not be to go talk to somebody else about them. Our initial response, according to this verse, is go and talk to God about them. It is to take them before God in prayer. And when we do that, since that's in his word, guess what? That's according to his will. And what is the promise here? The promise is if we take it to God in prayer, God will give them life. Talking about another person to somebody else, all it does is tear down the person. And when we talk to God about that person, it gives life. That's what the scripture is telling us here. And all of this refers to the person whose sin does not lead to death. So the question is what is this sin that John says that does lead to death? You know, the answer to that question has been turned over and over for 2,000 years, and you guys can all say hallelujah, thank you, amen, that Dale's not going to go over all the answers to those questions. Okay, so you can go home and fix your mom lunch, okay, or take her out or whatever you're going to do. But I think, after a little bit of reading, I think that the sin that leads to death is akin to the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit that you read about in Mark's Gospel chapter 3, Matthew chapter 12, and it talks about it there, but it's a bitter, hardened resistance to the truth of God as it's revealed in Jesus Christ. That's what it is. It's that stubborn defiance to God's word. It's not the magnitude of the sin which prevents the pardon and forgiveness of the sin. It's the attitude and the disposition of the sinner. Because the sinner who refuses to find cleansing and forgiveness, he refuses to go to the only place that it's offered. What did John say? 1 John 1:9. We all know it. You know, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So there's a source of cleansing. So if there is sin that leads to death, it surely has to be tied up with the attitude and the disposition of the one that's doing the sinning. Now, over the years in ministry, I've met a lot of people who are scared to death and worried that they might have committed the sin that leads unto death. Now, if you're here this morning and you've ever had that thought, let me be quick to say, if you're worried about it, that's a sure sign that you haven't done it. All right? Because you think about this. If you had committed the sin that leads unto death, guess what? You wouldn't care. You wouldn't think about it. There's not an ounce of repentance inside of you. No interest in forgiveness. The sin that leads to death is by its very nature, rejects the means by which that sin can be forgiven. So if you sin, and in that sin you reject the only means whereby your sin may be forgiven, then what else is your sin going to do except lead you to death? Anyway, that's my two cents on that. Then beginning in verse 18, we have three shouts of confidence. It's we know, we know, we know. In 18, 19, and 20, we know, we know, we know. Verse 18, we know that anyone born of God does not continue to sin. And we've seen that phrase before. John isn't saying that Christians are incapable of slipping into sin. He's saying that Christians do not habitually commit sin. They do not habitually persist in sin. And why? Well, the answer is given at the end of the verse. Why? Because God protects them from the evil one. Now, the verse can be a little bit confusing because it speaks of everyone who has been born of God, and the next phrase says, he who is born of God, and you go, well, what's the difference, right? That sounds a little confusing. How do we know the difference between those two things? So let's take it a little bit slow here. We know that everyone who has been born of God, stop there. Who is that? Who's everyone that's been born of God? That's the person who's received Christ as Savior and Lord. Then John says that person does not keep on sinning. They do not habitually sin. And why? Why do they not habitually sin? Because he who was born of God. Now who is that? That's Christ. Because Jesus Christ, the only begotten of Son of God, protects you. And the evil one does not touch him. That's what that is. The Son of God protects the children of God. Now, we're not immune to temptation. The evil one is malicious. The evil one is strong. But as John has said earlier, God, Jesus Christ, has come to destroy the works of the devil, the works of the evil one. We saw that earlier. But the evil one seeks to try and gain a hold. Our protector, Jesus Christ, is stronger than the enemy. Now, these days, there's a preoccupation with the devil. I mean, there are two great dangers here. One is that you don't believe in the devil at all, don't worry about him. And the other one is we believe in him so much that we think we can't resist him, that he's so powerful. And the question often comes up, well, what part of my life can the devil get a hold of? Can a believer be possessed? One more time, verse 18. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who is born of God was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. That's pretty categorical, isn't it? The evil one does not touch him. That is a Christian certainty. A Christian certainty. It reminded me of a story about a little girl whose mother was disciplining her for kicking her little brother in the shins and pulling his hair. That's never happened in your house, has it, Jamie? No, not in that household. Never. And the mom goes, Sally, why did the devil make you kick your brother and pull his hair? And Sally answered, the devil made me kick him, but it was my idea to pull his hair. Right? The idea that the devil can touch a believer or make a believer do anything is not true, because you know what? We don't do anything that we don't already want to do. Anyway, fourth certainty, a new perspective on life. Verse 19, we know that we are from God. And I like the NIV here, which says we know that we are children of God. That's what we know. Everywhere you go these days, they want two forms of ID. Well, they don't want two forms of ID when you vote. They don't want any ID when you vote. But everywhere you go, that's what they want. If you ever had to go get your Tennessee real ID, they want more than two forms. They want four or five different forms of identification. And, you know, you go on Google. Google wants two forms of ID. Apple wants two forms of ID. They want to know that you are who you say you are. Beloved, if you're in Christ, there's no doubt as to who you are. You are his child. Your identity is wrapped up in him. And so let that sink in. Let that soak into your soul. Marinate yourself in the fact that you are a child of God, that you belong to him. As verse 20 says, he has given us understanding. He has given us knowledge of him who is true, even Christ, the true God and eternal life. Verse 20 also tells us that this truth has been given to our minds. It's penetrated our hearts. It's activated our wills. But beyond all of that, you know, knowing the truth of God, it's not memorizing verses. It's not knowing specific doctrines so much as it is this. It's a knowledge of the truth that it is about meeting, knowing, loving, and living in intimate fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the truth. That's what it is. And do you know that? Do you know that you've met him this morning? Has there been a day or a time in your life when you met Jesus? And having met him, you believed him, and having believed him, you have lived with him, and having lived with him, there's no doubt in your mind that 1 John chapter 5, verse 19 applies to you as much as it does to anyone else. That you know that you're a child of God, that you live in intimate fellowship with him across all areas of your life. That absolute knowledge that comes from the perspective of who we are. And then our perspective on where we are is in verse 19. We are children of God, the second half of verse 19, and we know that the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. That's the Christian perspective. That's the biblical perspective. You go out and you tell a lot of people that, and they look at you like you're from Mars. You mean to say that the devil's in charge of this world? You're crazy. But that's what the Bible tells us. John tells us two things in this verse with absolute certainty. First, we're the child of God. Second, you live in a world that is held in the grasp of the evil one. The whole world is under his control. They're asleep. They're asleep in the hands of the enemy, and they don't even know it. Time magazine publishes its man or woman of the year, its person of the year, and you know, commercials fill the airwaves, and people communicate in ways we've never before. Social media platforms, and cell phones, tablets, laptops, desktops, whatever, and it all goes on without any belief, without any knowledge regarding what is ultimately true about this world, that it is in the control of the evil one. And somebody asked, well, is the devil more powerful than God? Let me be clear. No! All right? No, he is not. The Bible is clear. The devil is a created being. God is the creator. By definition, the creator is greater than the created thing. All right? So know that. At the end of the day, the devil serves the purposes and the plan of God. But the devil makes us promises. He promises to make us free. And the promises are nothing but an illusion. And we see these promises, the devil's promises, in the things of our 21st century, in the things that the world is occupied with. And for, you know, alcohol, sex, drugs, and gambling. Okay, and if you have any doubt that those four things are what the world is preoccupied with, just watch an hour or two of TV and see what the commercials are about. Sometimes all four of them are rolled into one. And since sports gambling has been legalized on the internet here in the state of Tennessee, you can't listen to whatever 99.1, the sports animal, without a commercial about gambling, a 60-second commercial where 55 seconds tells you how gambling is going to change your life and give you money, and in the last 5 seconds, it's 1-800 if you have gambling trouble. You know, who's in charge there? Who wants to know what's going on? Who cares about you? It's the Lord. And all of these things are unwitting attempts on the part of people to escape from the slavery of the world. We live in a world of people that are searching. We are searching for personal satisfaction. That's what men and women are trying to gain. Personal satisfaction. I guess the Rolling Stones said it pretty well, though. Mick Jagger, I can't get no satisfaction. And I've tried, and I've tried, and I've tried. And I can't. I've been here, I've been there, I've been everywhere. But you know what it's like drinking salt water? When you're parched, the more you drink, the more you need. And the more you drink, the more the longing for the thirst is there. Beloved, there's no doubt That we who belong to Jesus Christ, we who are the members of the Church of Jesus Christ, live in a world that is held in the grip of the enemy. And your friends don't know what's happened to them. The question for us, though, is not to sit here and condemn. You know, you guys don't know what's going on, poor, pitiful you. So what's our attitude? What are we supposed to do? Well, you turn, I believe, to the little book of Jude, one chapter, verses 21 through 23. We're not called to run away. We're not called to have an attitude of indifference. It's a matter of involvement. It's a matter of compassion. Jude, verse 21. It says, keep yourselves in the love of God, that's believers, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And so, well, what are we supposed to do while we're waiting? What should we do? Listen to this. Have mercy on those who doubt. Be merciful to your friends and neighbors who don't know Christ. Save others. How? Snatching them out of the fire. Well, how do I do that? Tell them about Christ. Snatching them out of fire. To others, show mercy with fear, with reverence. Humbly sharing the gospel. Hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Live a godly life. That's what we're supposed to do. That's the strategy for living in the world. We don't run and we don't hide someplace. We are identified with the world and its need and separated from the world in its sin. That brings us, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, to the final verse, right? Of 1 John. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Most of the commentators say they don't know what in the world that verse is doing there. So all I'm going to do, I'm not smarter than those guys, but I'm going to venture a guess. All right? Where does the world express its opposition to God more than idol worship? Now, you're not going to go here to downtown Kingston and find statues where people are bowing down to them on the street there. You're not going to find that. But you know what? We have idols in this world. Our world is filled with self-made people who worship their creator. And who is that? Themselves. We're supposed to blow our own horn. We're supposed to do our own thing. We're supposed to glorify ourselves, honor ourselves, and serve ourselves. No, that's not what the Bible says. The scripture tells us that we're to honor God, serve God, glorify God, not self, not another person. And you see, an idol is anything that substitutes or takes the place of God. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. You can make an idol out of your family. I see people who've made an idol out of their children or out of their spouse. We need to be aware also of the God of adopting, and this is rampant in our society right now, of adopting a radical theology of our day that's all around us, that's nothing more than enthroning man-made ideas, and they take the scripture and they twist it to their own use, and that's a whole other sermon. If you want it, I'll send it to you. I sent it to Joe last night. It's about an hour long, but it's a good one. But that's what this is about. And we can't have the fundamental size God of the pocket size God of fundamentalism. You know, where we've got God in a box and he does A, B, and C, and we've tamed him. No. The God of Scripture is anything but tame. Anything but tame. Anything that we use as a substitute for God and God alone is an idol that we need to keep ourselves from. And I can't think of a more fitting and simple statement to face tomorrow morning with. Keep yourselves from idols. Flip it on its head, give yourself to God. Give yourself to God. Let us pray. Lord, we praise you and thank you for your word. Lord, may we give ourselves to you. We thank you for the certainties that we find here, the certainty of salvation, the certainty of answered prayer, the certainty that you keep us and love us and hold us in through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, the certainty that one day that you will return, Father. And we thank you for the love that you show us. We thank you for the lessons and the things that we have learned from your word, from this letter written and given to us by the power of your Holy Spirit and the author of your grace, your Holy Spirit and your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 627, Cares Chorus. We'll sing it through twice, and I believe this hymn is made for mothers. Let's stand, please.
Lord, once again we come before you, and we do indeed come before you today and cast all our cares upon you because you care for us. Lord, we again want to pause and give you the glory and the honor and the praise through your Son, Jesus Christ. And now may him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in his presence blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be all glory, majesty, dominion, and power from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. Remember, moms, you can pick up your little flower from Kaylee going out the front door, and you're Missy, aren't you, from Missy going out the back door. Thank you.